Welcome back for some more Torment, Tires of Numenera. I'm the RPG chick. We need to head through this light.
Go.
Whatever. Light thing, tear in fabric of reality, whatever you call it. We need to get back to the necropolis and enter the code for Ronos Cai'sul, the original Ronos Cai'sul's tomb. Bloop. Or bloop, 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 bloop.
I am the very soul of action.
You sure are. I want to see something. I just want to price an item or two. So spray flesh. Does he have the improved spray flesh? I don't think so. Twenty-three points of health on all allies. Pretty cool. So as far as spray flesh is 40 each. Let me just write this down. I want to compare his prices with what's her name in Milavast. This is speed. That's helpful too. The speed one is 40. Looks like everything's, all these little things are 40. Yeah, 40. Encephalic rush. I want the enhanced version of this, though. And that is not... I do not see that. Alright, in we go.
Right.
Of course, he does have some unique items, which... I'm probably going to buy that generator one. I have to just... bite the bullet and sell some of these oddities. They're worth quite a few hundred.
Let's go.
Some of them on their own. Alright, we already know. Let's see if we can just get rid to it. The code for Ronos Cai'sul's tomb. Suddenly we are somewhere else. So the Ronos Cai'sul out in the Tomb of Dead Heroes merely took his name. Let's look at these first.
All right.
He's not the original. So this is Choi's father. It was tough being me. Chance Tarka.
Go.
Our last breaths in this tomb, at last we are free. Our two hearts afloat in rivers of time, finally beyond this reality. Our two souls released, like birds they fly away. Finally together for all eternity. Was it you two who were together for all eternity? Jean-Francois and Elodie. Oh, two others. I love this theme. So what is coming out of this? Are those insects?
Yes.
Or some kind of particles? As you touch the engravings on the epitaph, you feel familiar stirrings of air, pushing your eyes toward the imperfections on the surface. As with Choi's tomb, the glyphs of the truth curl into shape as distortions of the air and form themselves into the name of the deceased, Ronos Cai'sul. More words begin to form, taking shape like clear smoke. Examine archives, display likenesses, or leave. Examine archives. A whisper of wind tickles your ear. Protection of archives enabled. Speak the code and read freely. Huh. As you remember the words of Choi's marker, your name will live forever. And so you whisper that name, Choi. It works. Reams of potential information begin spilling into the air, hidden behind these words. History of Roy Ronos Cai'sul, experiments, bequests, or genealogy. Right, history. Well, this is going to take quite a while, isn't it? Lighted images appear on the currents of air, subtly distorted, and they show the progression of Ronos Cai'sul's life. A voice, slightly modulated through the wind, speaks. Ronos Cai'sul was born Ronos Genvin, an only child in a successful merchant family of Sega's Cliffs. His parents sought for him a position within the bureaucracy. He showed an early aptitude for the gentlemanly pursuits of governing, weaponcraft, and poisons. His interests took him elsewhere. He became fascinated by the secrets of the ancients and experimented with their lost knowledge under the tutelage of the Aeon priests. As one of their number, he sought the secrets of life and established himself in the field of medicine, focusing particularly on those damaged by the Numenera. He married Rinda Cai'sul, taking her name for himself. Interesting. And their family. It's not very often you hear of a man taking the woman's name. They had a daughter named Choi. She was the new center of Ronos's life until the Children of the Endless Gate abducted and murdered her. Yeah, that may be sad. Some kind of sacrifice or something. Ronos vowed to avenge Choi's death and destroy the cult. This vendetta consumed him. Options now include a return to the main tree, where you can hear and read about his experiments, or you can continue with Ronos Cai'sul's vendetta against the Children of the Endless Gate. Let us continue with the history. With the loss of his daughter, Cai'sul resigned from the Aeon priests and turned his full attention to destroying the cult. By then they had moved on, leaving with him no object for his revenge. The voice flatly notes, Rinda Cai'sul took her own life. Ronos redoubled his efforts, sold all that he possessed, and devoted himself to finding the children. In time, he hired an explorer named Marcissa, sounds familiar, to assist in this pursuit. There was a pause, then neither returned. Years after disappearing, Cai'sul sent a letter to his oldest mentor. The voice quakes slightly. In it, Cai'sul explained that he had found the children and their leader, Inifir. He wrote, Inifir and the others are victims, not monsters. They are prisoners of pain, and Inifir is a slave to dark masters beyond our plane. Rather than seek vengeance, I will endeavor to set them free.
I'll remember that.
Some months later, Cai'sul's body was transmitted to that mentor as well, and many years after that, the body of his guide, Marcissa, was deposited in the Valley of Dead Heroes. Thus ends the story of Ronos Cai'sul, entombed herein. His wife, Rinda Cai'sul, is interred in her family's ossuary in Sega's Cliffs. The marker of his daughter, Choi Cai'sul, can be found at 4221. Marcissa's tomb lies at 1254. Okay. 1254. I know this appears in our journal, but how do you spell Marcissa? Yeah. I like to have it in front of me. The voice crackles to a halt and the main menu returns, and most probably it will be a location we already know and it will show up there. Impossible. Oh, it is? The code for Marcissa's tomb is the same as that of the Endless Gate. The history continues as before and again recites the codes for Choi's tomb to Marcissa's. That's interesting, because we can replay the history, but not the second part of the history. Which is funny. Experiments. A voice speaks. Experiments included vivisection and necrosection on a variety of creatures across the Protectorate's biome. These led to investigations into cross-dimensional manifestations and psychoses, a field of study Cai'sul abandoned upon the death of his daughter. A formal list of scientific citations follows. Alright, that's it. Bequests. A subdued male voice speaks. While Scarlark Cai'sul liquidated the overwhelming majority of his estate shortly before his disappearance, certain family trusts and ongoing honoraria and royalties remained. These were assigned to the Aeon priests of Sega's Cliffs until confirmation of Cai'sul's death. At that time, his remaining properties escheated to the city. A list of financial instruments and revenue sources scrolls across the screen. Genealogy. A voice of indeterminate gender reports, Scholar Cai'sul Ni Genvin conducted extensive research into his background. He has uncovered trace evidence that he is distantly related to the slave families, though further research suggests that his particular branch was excised 150 years prior to his birth. He married Rinda Cai'sul, and they produced one daughter named Choi. She perished, and with her passing, both the Cai'sul and Genvin lines vanished. Interesting. Ronos Cai'sul was tracking Inifir and the cultists. His epitaph mentioned a guide named Marcissa, also interred in the necropolis. I feel like I'm getting closer to an answer. Hopefully the trail will end in her tomb. 1254.
Ready.
No, I'm not going there now. Not yet, anyway. The code for both the Endless Gate and Marcissa's tomb, which is the same. Oddwald. Yeah, I'm trying to find anybody to help Aretas. I don't think it would be Oddwald, but then again, this game has a way of surprising you. Who knows, he might know of a doctor. I'm hoping it looks like it's just somebody that we haven't met yet, or someone back in Sega's Cliffs, which I can't get back to. He hides because of his sorrow. I'm gonna take a peek here. Najma. No, okay.
Yes.
Never let it be said that I was bereft of virtue, even if I never fully understand how to live by it. Guthrum Aquitaine. Okay, I'm trying to find out if we run across that guy again.
Fine.
Silver, yeah. An arrow. Up and to the left.
Yes, now.
About up and to the right. So these are all just markers, guys, which I'm not bothering with these. About just
ready.
I had a name, but I remain nameless. Zoran Sterevsky. Well, you have a name.
Yes.
How about down and to the left?
Yes.
After a life spent accumulating knowledge, may he finally find peace in his collection. R.C. Allen.
Let's go.
So where are we anyway? We are at 1341. What'd I do? Random?
Yes, now.
3, 2, 2, 4, how about, down.
All right.
We're at 3, 3, 4, 4. Okay, just one more. Randomly. No. Arrow. Down is to the right. So after you guys are bored, I'm just trying to see... trying to find this guy. We ran into him randomly.
All right.
Look at these things. The glorious forge forever! And my voice cracks. Brannock Dranme.
Fine.
Okay. Let's... we're at 3, 3, 4, 5. Let's go to... back to Milavast. First cast-off's tomb. I want to see how much she's selling those things for. Random items.
All right.
Alrighty. I am the very soul of action. I think he was saying it. Lady Anche. Anche, whatever. So things like this. Oh, that's amplified. She's selling them for the same amount. 40. 40, okay. I'm gonna end up selling some stuff here. Well, definitely this. Crossbow. Oh, I do have one. Concentrated spray flash. Mm-hmm. I'll sell the heavenly submission thingy. That's cheap. I'll hold on to that. Sell the beads of Mother Tamaz. I really don't want to sell these things. That's what it is. So I find it interesting about this is there's no, like, finalized sale kind of thing, or finalized transaction. As soon as you, like, choose it, that's it. So let's let her upgrade Tibir. 130 shins. Oh, wait. Oh, Tibir's the only... wait! Did I fix Aratus? Hold up. Oh, duh. We fixed Aratus before. I have to go back and make a note there. Make a note. I make a note for me to make a note. Note. on Eretus' upgrade, because I was looking through Tybeer like, something's wrong, it wasn't changed. I guess I got confused. We upgraded Eretus. Lady Ansh adjusted Eretus's shirt to offer limited protection to blasts of raw energy. And she modified Eretus's doublet so that it provides significantly improved shielding. Okay, so let's look at Tybeer before we upgrade him. His, Sark, I'm making lots of notes here. His Sark has 3 armor and 2 resistance. And his cloak has, plus 5% evasion and plus 10% willpower. So let's see how much these improve. Can't believe I made a mistake, guys. Alright, Tybeer, finally. His is the most expensive. Improves Tybeer's Sark and Mantle. Good as done, she says, cradling a fist in her glowing palm and murmuring under her breath. The light swells. Tybeer arches an eyebrow at you as his armor begins remaking itself. If I end up naked at the end of this, you'll only have yourself to blame. And if not, thank you. So now we have 5 armor and 3 resistance. So we gained effectively 2 AC and 1 resistance. Lady Ansh treated the materials of this shirt to make it a more functional protective garment. More importantly, she didn't ruin its looks. Let's look at his other thing. So, looks like the evasion remained the same, but his willpower increased from 10% to 20%. Lady Ansh imbued the mantle with invigorating energies. So what I am doing now, I am trying to better equip ourselves so that we can fight this, fight these cultists and the unnamed thing with the teeth that attack. And plus, we're supposed... we're supposed to take care of all of our, you know, outstanding things. I should prepare myself and tell her when I'm ready. So we should be strong. I'm not sure, but I'm thinking even stronger than, this than fighting these guys and this thing with the teeth that I'm guessing we're gonna have to face at the end of all this. So that leads back there as well. Endless horror. It leads to the same one. 1254. 1254. Lost Shepherd. I don't know who can help him. Someone knowledgeable. I think we have to get back to Sega's Cliffs to do that. And I'm not sure when or if we'll do that. So that's 7 heart and wrestled mind. Oh, yeah. Let's do that too. Okay, so let's buy and sell more crap. Alright, so what does she have that might be useful, besides little things? I guess this lasts for the entire battle? I could use this possibly for the last battle against those cultists where there's like 7 or 8 of them. Every time you increase them, every time you like find a group of them, their amount is increased by 1. Or it may be random, but that's the way it happened in my playthrough last time I was there and died. So this is pretty neat. That's a lot of damage. 8 physical damage. And it's 273, which is a good amount, but we can afford it now. Active entire crisis. This looks neat too. I like this. Plus two resistance. Hey, look at that. Then again, this is pretty neat. The Chuckling Shroud does have plus 20% willpower. I think I'm going to hold off on that at least for now. I do want to get Spray Flesh. Oh, this. Yeah, get this thing. Let's see what's going on with these two rings. How much money do I have? 472. Getting broke again. We have a ref. And where's the other one? I hate it. We got holes and it goes and fills the holes we give. Let's move this. Oh, shit. The only way is to move the thing up one by one. Can't scroll. So we do have this. It's important to know. Oh right, we used it once. That's right. And then we died in that playthrough, so we restored. That's why we no longer had it. But now we're back to another reality. So this other part of the ring. So I want to just move everything this way. Bear with me, guys. Is this it? Varath. Varath and Araf. You pull the first ring fragment from your bags. At first, it looks like you've misplaced the second. Then you find it pressed into a fold at the exact opposite end from where you found the first one. You reach down to grab it, but find that you can't. The fragments reject each other with a force beyond magnetism alone. You pick up the second one with your other hand and hold them in opposing palms. Examine Varath. You hold the ring fragment to your eye. The fragment's edges are rough, as if sundered by a mighty strike, but on one end you can still see a socket that might have fit in a gemstone or something else, like the other part of the ring. You weigh the other ring fragment in your hand. The fragments feel like they should match somehow. The protrusion and socket clearly fit. It is almost as if they cry out to you to be joined. Let's examine Araf. I have a feeling whatever this is, it could be a powerful artifact once we put it together. You hold the ring fragment in one hand, though it seems like this should be impossible. The small thing is incredibly heavy. A small protrusion extrudes from one end of this fragment. Combine. Pinching the fragments between thumbs and forefinger, you struggle to bring them together. The force repelling them is not magnetism. It's almost as if someone is holding your hands apart with impossible, contemptuous strength. Nevertheless, there must be a way to join Araf and Varath. You just haven't found it yet. Oh, I require specialized Tidal Affinity skill. Push the fragments together by brute force. 90%. No! Failure! Damn it! Pinching the fragments between thumb and forefinger again, you struggle to force them together. Your hands tremble as you push with all your might. For a few seconds it seems like you're bringing your hands closer together, but perhaps this is only imagination. Finally, your energy expelled, you are forced to cease your attempt. The fragments' repelling force simply too strong. Attempt again. 100% now. Success! Hopefully they don't destroy the thing. Ooh! Looks Looks like it worked. Ever so slowly, you force the ring fragments together. Now we have zero might. Pushing your way through the massive force repelling them. The closer you bring Arif and Vareth together, the more they seem to resist. Beads of sweat form on your forehead, and your muscles scream in agony. But then finally, the moment you force the rings to touch, the repelling force completely dissipates, and the two fragments eagerly latch on to each other. The complete shadow ring lies in the palm of your hand, simmering with barely restrained power.
Ooh.
Pocket the ring. The shadow ring. Ornament. 4 resistance, plus 2 relativistic damage on attacks. Ignores resistance. You found Arif and Vareth, the two halves of the shadow ring, and with great effort reformed the object that had been shattered by your sire. The resulting artifact looks like a plain dark gray metal ring. When worn, it redirects powerful forces into any target struck. So we have beads of time never ending. Which is also awesome. Look at all the things it does, but let's try this. I don't suppose we can put it... No. Okay. We'll have to rest again before we go fight these cultists, because I have zero might now.